Good evening and welcome to Tucker Carlson Tonight. For decades now, you've been hearing about the threat that global climate change poses to this country and to the world. Al Gore warned you about all of it in a best-selling book and an award-winning documentary. Bill Nye, the science guy, has done a bunch of internet videos on the subject. Chelsea Clinton often tweets about it passionately. This stuff is serious, okay? How serious? Well, here's the scientific consensus on what will happen if we don't immediately pass some sort of democratic global warming bill. Watch.
The city is headed for a disaster of biblical proportion.
What do you mean, biblical?
What he means is Old Testament, Mr. Yes. Mayor. Real wrath of God type stuff.
Exactly.
Fire and brimstone coming down from the skies. Rivers and seas boiling.
40 years of darkness, earthquakes, volcanoes.
The dead rising from the grave.
Human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together. Mass hysteria.
Sorry, that was from 1984. It's a clip from Ghostbusters. But things have gotten much more dire since then. Human sacrifice, the dead rising from the grave, cats and dogs living together, those were the old predictions. We'd be lucky to get off that easy now. A new generation of Democratic office holders is thinking bigger than that and far more apocalyptically. Move over, Al Gore. These kids are serious. Watch.
We're like, the world is going to end in 12 years if we don't address climate change. And your biggest issue is... Your biggest issue is how are we going to pay for it? And, like, this is the war. This is our World War II.
Okay, so to recap the terms of this conversation, this is a matter of total war. The world will end if we lose that war. Any consideration of cost is immoral. That's what they're saying. This is not the language of compromise and moderation. It is the language of fundamentalist theology. Just a few years ago, they were telling us we could fight global warming with carbon offsets and slightly higher gas taxes. Now they're demanding that we give up airplanes and walk to work. But you gotta give it this, the Green New Deal does make a kind of internal sense. Hysterical predictions require hysterical reactions. Half measures don't cut it when you're fighting a world war for the future of this planet. Maybe that's why Democrats seem all in on this. Every single Democratic senator running for the Democratic nomination right now has endorsed the Green New Deal. Cory Booker, a vegan lawyer who represents Wall Street, describes the fight against carbon as at least as morally significant as the fight against Adolf Hitler. Watch this.
There's a lot of people now that are blowing back on the Green New Deal. They're like, oh, it's impractical. Oh, it's too expensive. Oh, it's all of this. If we used to govern our dreams that way, we would have never gone to the moon. And when the planet has been in peril in the past, who came forward to save Earth from the scourge of Nazi and totalitarian regimes? We came forward.
Who came forward when the Germans bombed Pearl Harbor? We did. Okay, we give up. Let's take this seriously for a minute because it is at the very center of our national conversation. Let's concede that global warming imperils the Earth. And that we need a mass mobilization of Americans to fight it. Solar-powered landing craft on the beaches of this generation's Normandy. No cost is too high, no sacrifice too extreme. Cory Booker is our Patton. Let's stipulate that's all true and not flagrantly insane. Who exactly is our enemy in this war? Well, carbon, of course. Carbon is poison. Al Gore told us that 25 years ago. And who is the biggest carbon dealer on planet Earth, the El Chapo of CO2? You probably assume it's America because nobody has bothered to update you on this question. But in fact, it's not America. It's not even close to America. It's China. China is now the undisputed kingpin in the carbon trade. China throws more than twice the amount of deadly carbon into the atmosphere than this country does. China is the problem. And that's true even if you're just a regular environmentalist who still believes in the Earth and are skeptical of received climate theology, because China is also the biggest physical polluter in the world. China dumps almost as much non-degradable plastic into the oceans as the rest of the world combined. They have not banned drinking straws in Shanghai. So it's pretty clear, if you're worried about killing polar bears and poisoning fish with mercury, you should be very worried about China. Because they're the ones who are doing it. But nobody in our ruling class seems to know this or care. You don't see Democratic activists or professional environmentalists camped outside the Chinese embassy in protest. Nobody's demanding sanctions on China till they stop polluting. That screeching moron Ocasio-Cortez isn't telling China to give up coal and oil and natural gas and nuclear power within a decade. No way. The left isn't doing any of that because the left loves the Chinese government. It's their model for governing. Just a few years ago, the California governor, Jerry Brown, flew, yes, flew, all the way to the Chinese mainland to praise its fascist government for its environmental leadership. For real. You see what's going on. The Green New Deal is not about the environment, just like gun control is not about school shootings, and speech codes have nothing to do with sensitivity. Nothing is what they say it is. What it's really about is punishment and control. The Green New Deal is a religious document. It punishes America for the sins of its prosperity. The only atonement it offers is turning over full control of the entire U.S. economy to the Democratic Party. That's the indulgence they require. They're using moral blackmail to get it. Of course they are. Theocrats always do. Nate Lerner is executive director of Build the Wave, and he joins us tonight. So, Nate, we're being told that we need to fight World War II on behalf of the environment, but fight it against ourselves, is what they're saying. We have to wage war on our own economy. Why wouldn't we be turning this effort outward toward the world's biggest polluter, China, and forcing them to clean up the globe? Why aren't we doing that?
Yeah, that's a really fair question, but how can we ask China to step up to the plate if we're not doing it ourselves? Ocasio-Cortez, for example, is in no position to demand that of China when our own government refuses to invest the funds and resources that we need to into changing our energy infrastructure. So we need to start leading the way on this. We need to start showing that this is something that can work and create jobs and strengthen the economy ask them to join us.
Okay, I get it. I mean, I've heard that argument's, I mean, that's been the kind of way that the left evades the question for the past 25 years. But the new numbers show... Well, it's not really an answer because China emits double the CO2, more than the United States does.
In fact, they're three or four times the size of us.
Okay, but you're making excuses for them. We're talking about the future of the Earth here. We could be gone in 12 years. This is an existential crisis. I'm taking the rhetoric of the left seriously, but they're not taking their own rhetoric seriously, because if they did, they would assign actual blame to the world's actual largest polluter, and that's China. But instead they make excuses like, well, China just needs inspiration from our moral leadership. No, why don't we say to China, this is a war. You're the enemy because you are destroying the protective ozone layer that protects the planet, and we're going to force you to change your ways. Why don't we do that?
All right, there's a lot of things to unpack there. Let's start with, you know, the rhetoric. This is not rhetoric that the world will end in 12 years. What Ocasio-Cortez was referencing was the UN Panel on Climate Change's report that came out recently that said if global energy infrastructure does not dramatically change in the next 12 years, it will be too late. So if we don't drastically change the way we produce energy,
the point that you're making is it's really serious, and I'm...
It's very serious.
I don't know if that's known or not, actually, but I'm assuming that you're right, and I'm taking your assumption and reaching the logical conclusion, which is, if this is really serious, we need to get after the people who are causing it, and
right,
it's China. And you made excuses for their behavior by saying that they can't really do anything until we lead the way. And
I didn't say that.
Well, you did.
I said we are not in a position to approach them and ask them to join us.
Why?
We pulled out of the Paris Climate Agreement.
The Paris Climate Agreement didn't ask them to reduce their carbon. What? No, it actually allowed them to increase the carbon they emit into the atmosphere.
But that's an example of where the U.S.'s priorities are right now.
That's insane. If you really believe this, then why aren't you telling the biggest polluter in the world to knock it off?
We absolutely should, but first we need to do it here domestically. And also, if you look at China, this is a completely false narrative that they're not investing anything. That they're not investing anything right now in green energy, because they are. They are reducing greatly.
I don't know what green energy is. I'm just telling you because it's such a large category, it has no meaning. I want to go to the science. And the science tells us they're emitting more than twice the carbon that we are. And yet you're making excuses for them and saying, well, we need to do it first because why? That's like saying we can't fight an authoritarian regime because we have voter fraud problems. No, they're destroying the earth and you're making excuses for them. And so all the environmental groups are taking their money. And don't you think you should be ashamed for doing that?
I'm not addressing the Chinese money. First of all,
yes, they are.
First of all, I'm not saying that the Chinese should not step up to the table. Absolutely not.
Step up to the table? They're destroying the earth.
So. They should absolutely join us in this. Of course, I'm calling on them to do that. Of course, they need to be part of this just as much as we are. But I'm saying that we cannot politically approach them from a geopolitical.
This is not geopolitical. It's moral.
How is our government supposed to go ask them to join us when we're not even doing this ourselves?
You're telling me that we need to shut down every
power plant. We need to put our money where our mouth is.
Yeah. Why? It's not about our money. It's about saving the earth. I'm using the rhetoric, which is a moral rhetoric, not an economic rhetoric, a moral rhetoric of every Democratic presidential candidate right now today and applying it to a foreign country that they like much more than they like the United States. And you're making excuses for that country. I honestly don't understand why.
Approaching this from a very logical standpoint when saying that the U.S. government cannot demand. They should demand, but it's not going to be effective. Unless we're also doing it ourselves. How does that not make sense? You can't tell someone to join you in a fight if you're not fighting that fight yourself.
Really? Okay.
You say, go fight climate change. We'll do it too. Don't worry about it. We just show them we are invested in this.
You're missing it. I don't think you're updating the numbers. They're polluting twice as much as we are. They're the world's biggest polluter by a factor of 100%. So it's not like we need to lead the way. They need to lead the way. Oh, you're making excuses for that.
Why? We are America. Oh. Why shouldn't we be leading the way in this fight?
Oh. I'm not making excuses for that. So we have a higher standard here. I see.
Yeah, of course. We do have a higher standard. We're the United States of America.
So we have to wage World War II against ourselves. That's exactly what you're saying.
We should have the Chinese join us, but we cannot fight. We cannot expect them to join us in this fight if we aren't doing it ourselves. I don't understand how you're not getting this.
Because it's their crime, and we should hold them accountable for it. Just my view.
We should. You are absolutely right. We should hold them accountable. Okay, but we need to hold ourselves accountable, too.
We're the guilty ones. Yeah, I get it. Okay. Nate, thank you very much. High-speed rail is central to the Green New Deal, which says that rail would replace cars. Okay. Does high-speed rail work? Huh. Has it been tried anywhere? How about our biggest state, California, which was trying to build a high-speed rail line between its two biggest cities, San Francisco and L.A.? And yet yesterday, it canceled that route. Why? Because it didn't work. The cost rose to a staggering $77 billion. Chuck DeVore has watched this up close. He's a former California State Assemblyman and vice president of the National Initiatives of the Texas Public Policy Foundation, and he joins us tonight. So, Chuck, what was suddenly a California story is now a national story because light rail is a centerpiece of the Green New Deal. Why didn't it work in California?
Well, it got too expensive. The travel times were way too slow. The ticket prices were about double what you'd pay for Southwest Airlines. And it became very apparent that they promised something that they couldn't deliver. They said they were going to have this project that would have all this private money and investment that wouldn't have to cause taxes to go up. Look, they haven't gotten a penny in private investment. The federal government's put $3.5 billion into it. And now they're in material breach of their agreement with the federal government. I think the federal government should ask for that money back and use it to build the wall.
So I'm just a little bit confused because it sounds like it's not that it didn't work in California. It sounds like it was a flaming disaster. It was a fireball of lies and embarrassment. And so why would you take that and make it the centerpiece of your energy policy?
Well, you had a lot of crony corporatism and big labor involved in selling this to the public. So it narrowly passed in 2008 with Obama at the top of the ticket, got 52.7% of the vote. It was backed by corporations like Siemens, the locomotive manufacturer out of Germany, and big labor. And it's basically been a crony corporate gravy train from day one. Now, the problem is, at the rate they're spending money, they wouldn't finish the route for about 100 years. And as I recall, we're all supposed to be dead by then. Isn't that how it's supposed to work?
Actually, I think it's 12 years. So I guess what you're saying is they're paying off their campaign contributors and calling it environmental policy. I think I've seen that before. Chuck DeVore, I appreciate your coming on and clarifying.
Thank you, Tucker.